So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Pranjal Sharma. First, a very important thing I have to say to you, that your lives are in danger. I'm not being alarmist, but your lives are seriously in danger. It's also the theme of this conference, of Mindrush, Disrupt or Die. And it's very important for you to understand why I say your lives are in danger, because, you know, this hotel may have told you what are the exits in case there is a crisis in the hotel, but in this situation, the exits are not too many. So, you know, you may have to struggle to find that. So lives are in danger, and why is that? Because of various reasons, but mostly because of automation. So, you know, the theme is also the fourth industrial revolution. Let me dwell on that for a minute before I come to automation. Fourth industrial revolution, as you know, is a series of, it's actually an umbrella term for lots of technologies, from drones to artificial intelligence to blockchain, which all, in effect, result in automation in some part of the work that we do. So I can tell you for certainty that almost everything that you do right now is impacted by automation. You live, work, sleep or not, but your lives are impacted by automation right now. So this is the title of my book, which is just out, Rise of, it's called India Automated. And it's a bit of a crazy thing to say, because in a country where 1 million people look for jobs every month, 1 million people try to join the workforce every month, but automation is rising. Is that good, bad or ugly? Are we headed for disaster, or something good can come out of it? So this is the fear. I want to ask you, how many of you in the room own a business? Okay, that's quite a few actually. And how many of you have a job? And how many of you are part of the gig economy, which also means unemployed? So I'll raise my hand too. So the thing is that all of you who are, I just saw two or three hands. I think the lady here, the gentleman there, and me on the stage. Three people who don't have a job. We are in the gig economy. The rest of you either own a business or have a job. I can tell you, in 6 months to 18 months, there will be more people raising hands in this hall. All of you, mark my words, in some way saying we are part of the gig economy. Why is that? Because your jobs may not be the same in the next 6 months or 8 months. And the businesses that you own, unless you're sitting a big pile of a few $1 million and a few hundred crores, and you don't want to do anything else except enjoy them, I think you're safe. But if you have a business, you might just want to take some money, step out, and you know, travel the world. This is what we are worried about. So the book is about how India has to embrace automation. It's happening despite the fact that you may or may not like it. There is a fear, but it's happening. It's happening faster than you realize. India is embracing, well, let's put it this way. Automation is happening to India, and India doesn't know how to embrace it. And in my book, and what I'm going to show you are a few examples of what's happening, and then, you know, if there's some time, I'd like to take some questions and thoughts from all of you over here. So one has to be prepared and be relevant. Be relevant is a polite way of saying prepare or die. Prepare or perish. Prepare or lose your life. And ignore and become useless. That's another polite way of saying it. I'm trying to be polite. So what is? Why do we need automation, and why is automation happening? And this is important for you to understand why automation happens, because things which are dirty, dangerous, dull, and difficult will be automated. Because you don't want any of you to be doing things which are either dirty, dangerous, dull, or difficult, correct? Who wants to do any of these things? I'm sure all of us have jobs which you find are incredibly dull, but there's a salary at the end of the month, so you know, you kind of tolerate it. Because you have EMIs to pay, and you have kids' education to worry about, or you have a significant other to maintain. Dirty, what's an example of dirty? And these examples which follow are what's happening already in the country. This is not an alien concept. This is not theoretical. This is ground reports of what's happening in India. Dirty. So cleaning of rivers, humans did it. People would go down and do it. Now boats which are automated are doing it. Dangerous. There are several such examples. I'm not going to bore you with that. I'd rather you buy my book. But here's an example of what scavenging. Do you know there are 5 million people in the country who are involved in manual scavenging? 5 million across the country, and that's an estimate. It could be more. A solution for them is robotic machines like that, which some municipal corporations, including Delhi and Pune, have started using. So there is a real good which is coming out of it. So first I was telling you that you have to prepare to die, but I'm also telling you that automation is not a bad thing because it's actually saving people's lives. Dull, of course we know what dull is. Dull is also having to listen to somebody after lunch without having enough caffeine in your system. But tax filing can be terribly dull, not just for you who's filing it, but also for the officers who are doing it. Imagine that we have a very tiny tax base of just about 4 crore people. What happens when there are, you know, 10 crore people who have to file taxes? What happens when another 15 crores came out of a country of 130 crores? Even if 10 crores people start filing taxes, will you increase the income tax department by the same level, in a commensurate level? You will not. So, if you didn't know already, e-filing is happening, but the Department of Tax, the CBDT, has a great program of automating all tax filing of tax refunds. Hopefully my money will come back to me and a robot will not, you know, digitize it and send it to some other person. But, you know, these things are happening as we speak. Now, automation is of two parts, is really two things. One is robotics, and you saw these huge figures of Sophia and everybody else, you know, who comes and talks and looks pretty cute when they have their blinking eyes speaking robotic metallic voices. But automation, and a large part of it is process automation, and a lot of you may have heard of it or may be deploying it, but that's really where the key effort is. And what's happening in the income tax department is really process automation. So hundreds of thousands and lakhs of income tax returns are being filed. They are being automatically processed, unless you're planning to hide money, in which case somebody will find you out. Difficult. So difficult is easy. Manual labor going into, you know, robots and cobots, and there are several companies in manufacturing in India in the automotive sector which are already using, you know, cobots and others. Now, automation in government is actually a very fascinating piece. A lot of us don't realize that state governments in India and the national government departments are using automation. And I'm linking it back to what I said about the tax department, but the postal department, you know, it still exists, but the postal department has an automatic mail processing center in the country, and there are several of these. One of them is near Terminal 3. As you depart and come towards the city, you'll see it on the left side. Now, this is an exciting example, which again, some of you may have heard of, but some of you may not have, but the Ministry of Child and Women's Welfare is using artificial intelligence and facial recognition to find missing children. And that's fascinating. Now, of course, there are privacy concerns around this in terms of facial recognition, but every technology has a great side and a terrible side, right? So it's about how you deploy those which really makes a difference. So I think this is a great example of how technology can be used for something really, really positive. Vehicle records, 250 million vehicles in the country, their records have been digitized. So, you know, nowadays, you may have seen, or maybe you may have suffered, you see a guy coming around, the traffic cop, he has your information on his mobile device. So they are also automating it, plus, what is not mentioned here, but testing of licenses for a driving license, the testing is being automated. So you don't have to bribe a guy to get a license and say that you are fit to drive. You actually go into a car, you drive it, and in the testing arena, there are sensors which will tell you whether you've passed or failed. Now, think of it also as a great example of corruption being, you know, sent away. Automation in enterprises is easy, but it spans healthcare, where AI is diagnosing x-rays, which is going to put a lot of radiologists out of business. So if any of you knows a radiologist, please tell them to look for another career or do something else to live lives, because the scanning of x-rays and imaging is already happening in some of the best imaging institutes in the country, private as well as government. Okay. Predictive maintenance is very important. Even those of you who are manufacturing units, and those manufacturing units are, you know, you want to upgrade them, you put sensors on every little piece, it tells you when things are breaking down. So the examples of companies who are in renewable energy, they have these huge windmills. Each costs about $2.5 million. But one little battery which burns down can bring the whole system down. It's happened to some of these companies in Gujarat. So what do? You put sensors all over. They automatically tell you what's going wrong. Something's going to, impacting the blade. Something is hurting the turbine. That tells you what's going on. automatically you get flash and red alert and you fix it. So the cost of a $50,000 battery can kill a $2.5 million windmill. So you need to know things like that to be able to manage this. How do we survive automation? So this is about the exit route. There are not too many exit routes over here, but I'm telling you that if you do not figure this out, you will possibly perish. How do you survive automation? Let's take an example of this. So since there have been several references to mobiles, which we can't live without, how often do you think your mobile updates? You get an update about downloading a new version of your software? Once in 6 months, 3 months? Depending on you know how good or bad the mobile phone service is or the Android maker is. But let's look at what we do, humans. It's about humans and non-humans, right? We get a degree and for the next 30 years, we are living off that degree. When was the last time we went to a classroom? Some of us may have gone to an MDP, but most of us get a degree and want to live off the degree for the next 20, 30, 40 years. How will you remain relevant if you want to depend on that skill? The most important piece is that your experience also doesn't matter because whatever you've learned in the last 25 years will not be applicable for the next 5 years. Who would have thought that WhatsApp would be used to make phone calls? You know, there's so much more things happening. For example, there's something called soft POS. Has anybody heard of soft POS? Has anybody heard of POS machines? Who knows POS machines? Okay. POS is not short form for possibility. It's point of sale. So point of sale machines, you get, you know, whenever you have to charge a card, those little machines come. Now that is being removed. Your phone will be a point of sale machine because there's new software which can do contactless cash transfer. So it's happening. So, you know, you may have heard of soft POS today. Mark my words, in 2 months, you'll think it's mainstream. So that's the speed at which things are changing. So 1 degree in 30 years, it's not going to make you, you know, survive. All of us, whether we are at entry level, whether we are blue collar, white collar, whether we are CEO level, all of us have to upgrade. And you've heard that before, but it's very important to know how do you remain relevant to the new changes. Very soon, people who are chartered accountants, I have friends who are CFOs who say that they don't have chartered accountants in their teams. They have data scientists. Similarly, lawyers will tell you that they don't have pure legal graduates in their teams because you can go and download a template for any legal agreement in 30 seconds. And that template is valid because all the language has been automated and put into a system where no court will deny it. So, got to upgrade. Got to upgrade like a mobile does, got to upgrade every 6 months. This is why, because, you know, we are living in a world where every time you see a screen or a glass, you want to touch it and make things happen. But, you know, there are no shortcuts to surviving. You've got to change yourself, both individually and institutionally, to make the most of automation. There are several terrific examples. Automation, if nothing else, brings you instant information for your business cycle. India is a data-poor country. The government doesn't know about anything in terms of how many jobs it's creating, how many people are employed, but in a factory where you would get a weekly, monthly report on what's going on today, you can get it instantly if you have the right kind of automation processes. So I'll end here, and I'd like to take some questions. Those of you who have survived this presentation, thank you. Can we have the lights and a mic here, please? To me, but perhaps not to everybody else. So, can we get a hand mic? Hello. Okay, the shock to the system has been very high. So, would you like to come here and ask, or maybe? Okay, no hand mics, but why don't you ask? Use your best voice. Right. Okay. I think a mic is traveling towards you. No. But you know, if there was automation, a sensor would have detected that somebody is speaking here and a mic would have dropped down on him. I didn't even mention drones, which could have come and picked up his voice. So, okay, now it has to be voice activated.
Hi, Pranjal. My question is on healthcare. So you said that no X-ray, all imaging is moving towards automation.
Has moved.
Has moved. I mean, maybe at a very metro level, still it's at infancy. But what else you think in healthcare is moving towards automation?
Robots and surgeries. Oh,
that's fine.
So robots and surgeries
are there. I'm talking about the diagnostics part.
You know, all kinds of diagnostics. So again, a path lab, a pathology lab is going to also be completely useless. There are companies, startups like Sick2Play, which have automated the entire process. You go and give a sample, and within minutes, you get a result. Because what they do, how does automation happen is because the artificial intelligence algorithm which has been written would have got loads of information which has been saved in the system. And the moment your sample goes in, it compares it to everything else and then tells you what you're likely to have. So most of the diagnostics are being automated. And it's a very simple thing if you look at it. Who is a good doctor? A good doctor is somebody who has looked at 10,000 patients or 20,000 patients. What that doctor has is terrific experience and understanding of what could have gone wrong or what could be wrong, right? But a young doctor doesn't have that. So artificial intelligence and automation will replace that doctor. You know, so there's something called the CDSS, Clinical Diagnosis Support System. So what it does is that even if I'm not a doctor, if you call me and say I have a headache, I'll have a system in front of me which will do a drop-down headache. What could be the possible causes? I could go through those drop-downs and in some way identify what could be wrong with you because I'll keep asking you questions based on that clinical diagnosis system. So all of that is happening. There's a company called Call Health which is doing that. It's Hyderabad-based, and they offer these solutions to people across the country. And there are, of course, medical professionals who are there who come to your house. A robot won't come to your house yet, but the diagnosis will be done by technology. Any other question? I see two hands at the back over there. Can we have the mic there? One, two, and then there's a gentleman here. So mic at the back or whoever's got the mic closest.
Hello.
Okay, sir, you have it.
Yeah. My name is Peshwa. There's a little bit of things going on. I have just two comments to make. I think I really like what you said, and I'll pick up the book and read a little bit more. My two comments are, first one, I actually see a little bit of automation, adding value back rather than extracting away value for many of the developed and developing economies.
Right.
So the first one I think is, from my experience, actually in order to do automation, you need to do certain amount of programming. There's a certain amount of technical expertise which needs to be built in. Like for example, I'm in hospitality business. We do a fair amount of now interaction with chatbots. And things are actually getting more specialized.
I know. There's some disruption on your side, but that's okay.
Finish. So, to me, actually, automation might actually help spinning off a little bit of new areas of employment / expertise. That's one.
Good point.
Second point is what automation, according to me, throws up is multiple data points. So, actually, analytics becomes fairly important.
Right.
Today, in many areas, we don't have analytics. So to me, automation actually might throw up new employment opportunities. Unfortunately, a lot of the, if you may use the word, the blue collar work or the lower level of work, unfortunately might disappear.
So it's not unfortunate because I don't think you want your children or anybody's children to be in blue collar work right now. I also see a great blurring of blue collar and white collar because as you have more cobots and robots and automated systems in assembly lines, it means you will have people who are computer scientists, perhaps, who are on the shop floor, and you can't call them blue-collar by any stretch. Blue-collar means that you got to have elbow grease. We don't want people wearing, vests, getting elbow grease and sweating their way through life.
Sorry, wrong usage of nomenclature.
No, great point. Thank you very much. I think two questions at the back because we're running out of time. Let me collect the questions and come back to you. The two questions there, and you have the mic, so I think you get precedence. Jiski Lathi.
Hi, can I speak? Hello.
Okay, you have the mic, sir.
Yeah. This may sound hilarious, but I want your viewpoint on There's a quote which says that an idol's brain is a devil's brain.
Correct.
And automation is well supported by AI and robotics. And it's definitely there to stay and going to take a lot of jobs and jobs of many people. In this context, there'll be a issue of no job and the time pass, so-called. So time pass is something that is, which I would like you to highlight in context with the ideal's brain, devil's brain.
Yes, I mean, there is an issue, what do you do with people? But my point is fundamentally, even though I began on a note of saying that, you know, all of us will die, the fact is that the impact is going to be less. I hope you know that more people lose jobs because of trade wars than because of technology. There are enough studies on that. When tariffs go up and down, where there's protectionism, that causes more job loss than technology as of now. But you have a good point, sir. You know, we'll have to discuss this. Issues of what people will do when they don't have much to do is an important point, but I don't really have the time to address that. But the issue is that we won't have so many people. Question at the back, and Shweta, just tell me how many questions we have time for.
Can I go now? Okay. Pranjal. So, keeping with the, this is Anjani Agarwal, keeping with the theme of this discussion, adoption is, behind the change that is happening on the front side of, technology. So, is there automation happening in fast-forwarding the knowledge base of people who are going to lose jobs?
It will have to. I don't think they have a choice.
It has to, but is there something happening on that front?
No, I don't think people are spending enough time in upgrading or becoming better and improving their knowledge. All of us feel, especially all of us who are close to 50 or above, that we know enough. We had a degree from a great college in 1923, and after that, we have done great work. We have led huge organizations. I don't need to know more. I don't think that attitude is going to work. So there needs to be an acceleration. And use this very simple analogy. If your phone needs an update every 6 months, why don't you need that? That's all. Thank you very much.